Warm welcome to this lecture series on organization behavior. We are in the chapter on motivation, and this is the third lecture in this chapter. I'll quickly summarize what happened in the previous lecture. We defined what is motivation. We also looked at the basic motivational process. So every behavior is driven by a need. When the need is satisfied, that particular need stops motivating a person. But we have multiple needs, and whichever need is dominant at that point in time drives our behavior, and needs cease to exist. So need as a powerful motive drives our behavior. So this is one important fundamental concept you should understand. We also looked at different types of motives. Motives means reasons behind a particular behavior. So these reasons or these factors which contribute to behavior can be classified into three types: primary motives, which are inborn or physiological motives; general motives are partially inborn and partially social; secondary motives are motives which we learnt from the society around us. We also looked at some concepts, some information about what are these psychological motives and how it influences our behavior. We also looked at conflict as a motive. So motive not necessarily means a positive thing which drives behavior. Sometimes it can be a negative irritation or a irritant which can drive behavior. So we looked at what are the different types of conflicts which can drive behavior. We also looked at money as a motivator. We discussed about the pros and cons of using money as a sole motivator in the context of workplace. So one important aspect of this using money as a motivator is, when you use money as a sole motivator, it can also become a demotivating factor, or it may make people unhappy if you just use money to motivate people. So it needs a lot of knowledge about the person and also the context, the behavior which you want to motivate. So all these understanding can help us frame or design a methodology where we can combine different factors along with money to motivate people. For example, let's say you are appreciating somebody's voluntary behavior. You cannot just like that give money and say good job and you know we expect more from you, because voluntary behaviors, many a times if you pay people for voluntary behaviors, they may not exhibit it in the next time. So instead, in just giving money, you can give them some material which they like, you know, maybe a book or maybe a, you know, medal or maybe a gift voucher, and also write a letter or a certificate saying that thank you very much for doing this, please accept our reward or please accept our token of gratitude. Okay. So you can give money, but you need to ensure that it is given in the right way, in the right time. Okay. This is what we saw in the previous class. So till this point, these are some of the things we discussed in this particular chapter. Now we are going to talk about theories of motivation. When I say theories are nothing but frameworks or certain principles which we can use to understand people's behavior. So here in motivation theories, we are trying to see what motivates people, or how motivation happens, or what is the process of motivation and things like that. So broadly, these theories which we are going to look at can be classified into two types: content theories and process theories. So content theories means theories which talk about what motivates people. Is it money, or is it appreciation, or is it relationships? So what motivates people? Another way of looking at motivation is how people get motivated, or If money is not a motivator, why it is not a motivator? Or if you have to use appreciation as a motivator, how can you use, or in what ways can you use appreciation as a motivator? Okay. So broadly, motivation theories can be classified into content theories and process theories. So we will look at some of the content theories first. Maslow's theory of needs, or Maslow's hierarchy of needs, is a very popular theory. In fact, this theory is widely used not just in organizational behavior context, but also in other context in psychology, in counseling psychology, in social psychology. So in many contexts, we can use this theory. So if you remember, in one of our earlier chapters, we looked at humanistic theories, or theories which spoke about, or which looked at human behavior from a humanistic point of view. In the first chapter, we spoke about how Hawthorn studies helped psychologists look at human behavior from a very humanistic point of view. So Maslow's theory is one of those earlier theories in humanistic approach, which looks at the dignity element of human behavior, and also believes that humans have a choice. Instead of just manipulating human behavior, people can make choice what kind of behavior they want to exhibit. Okay, so like the name suggests, need hierarchy, Maslow proposes a hierarchy. Hierarchy means different levels, and each level has an increasing level of importance. Okay, so according to Maslow, all of us have needs. If you remember, even in the previous slide, we saw we all have needs, and needs, we prioritize needs based on that particular situation, things like that. So Maslow also talks about needs. We all have needs, and our behavior are driven by needs. At any given point of time, even though there are many needs, at any given point of time, only certain needs motivate individuals. Okay, and this model is called a hierarchy because once a certain need is satisfied, or a person is satisfied at one level, he or she moves to the next level. So once you get satisfied, that particular thing will not satisfy you after that. You will move to the next level. In the next level, again, if you are fully satisfied, you will move to the third level. Similarly, there are five levels proposed by Maslow. So the basic level is physiological needs. The fundamental need of every human being is food and water. So, we all, when we get hungry, we seek food. And, thirst is also a powerful motivator. So we all fall in that category. But once we are satisfied at that level, okay, again, it's not like every time you go to that level. It's not like every time you get hungry, you go to the basic level. It is about your capacity to fulfill that need. Let's say you have the capacity to fulfill that need. You are not poor, So if you are in this level, if you're not able to satisfy even the basic need of hunger and thirst, then it means you are poor, or you are living in a very, underprivileged condition. The condition is like very, very bad, because either you are poor or because of external conditions like war or, social unrest and things like that. Otherwise, many of us, I will not say most of us, but many of us, we have the capacity to fulfill that need. It's not like we won't get hungry, but if you're hungry, we're not scared about whether we'll get food for the next meal or not. Okay, many of us. So once you are economically satisfied at this level, you are economically capable to fulfill your hunger and thirst whenever you feel that need, you move to the next level. Okay, so you're no more poor. You're not extremely poor. So once you have food and once you have the capacity to fulfill that need, the next need is security and protection. You need a house or you need a place to stay. Okay. So till that point, you will not, if you don't have food, you will not look for house or you will not look for a place to stay. Let's say you are lost in a forest. Okay. You don't have the capacity to, money won't work there. Okay. So what will you do? You'll search for food. After a certain point, when you are hungry and thirsty, you'll search for food. You will not search for a place where you can stay protected. The first thing is hunger and thirst. Once it is satisfied, you'll move to the next level. You look for a place to hide or a place to stay where you will not be physically harmed. For humans, it is also to some level psychological safety, which means you have people who can help you when you are in risk or when you are in danger. Okay. So you move to the next level, which is security and protection need, and you are driven by that need. So you will search for ways to be, feel secure and protected. Okay. So you will look for resources so that this security and protection will stay there forever. Okay. The second level is satisfied. You'll move to the next level. Human beings, once safety needs are satisfied, they move to the next level, which is social need. So till here, it is sort of biological needs. Physiological and safety, both are kind of, you know, you want to protect your body and want to live. So those are sort of basic needs. From third level, it becomes social needs. They are higher level needs. So once you have food, once you have the capacity to get food, once you have capacity to have a place to stay, the third need is you need people. You need people to love you. You need people to be friendly to you. You need people to talk. You need people to share your concern. You need people to show your love and also get love from others. Okay. So all these friendship, intimate relationship, parent-child relationship, all those things fall in this category, third level. So even in workplace, we seek relationships. Okay. So let's look at that. So I was talking about generally how people are driven by needs. Let's look at it from work context. So let's say you're a fresher. Okay. And the job market is very bad and there are like very few jobs available. There is a placements, you are sitting for placements after your college, okay, campus placement, and there are very few jobs. So instead of not having a job, at least some job you will take, isn't it? Even the basic, if they are giving very minimal amount, but that amount you can manage, so you will take that particular job. But let's say there are different options, then you look for a better option. That's a different story. Let's say this is the only option available, you'll take that job. So once you have that job, you will try to get job security, or you know, you want permanency in the job. You don't want people to fire you at any given point in time. Job security doesn't mean that you want to be there forever. Job security means there is some level of certainty in terms of you can decide when to leave. Okay, it's not like they will decide when you should leave. They won't fire you, but you can decide to quit. So that is job security. Once you have job security, what you will do is you will look for friendship. You know, you in workplace, you need colleagues who treat you well. You need a boss. You will look for a boss, or you will demand, or you will, you know, your boss, you will expect your boss to be nice to you. Okay, so all those things are social needs. Fourth level is even one level higher, which is esteem needs and recognition needs. So you will expect others to respect you. So in third level, it is acceptance. Okay, social needs is you need acceptance of others. But the fourth level is respect. You need people to respect you. You know, you want them to treat you with respect and with some level of status. You need a a certain level of recognition from people, okay, so which is slightly higher than belonging needs. Esteem needs are also about self-esteem needs. The fourth level is also about self-esteem. You want to do something in your workplace which will make you feel happy about it, okay, and you want to do your work in a way that people will say, okay, if for this particular job this person is the best person, or he or she is a best teacher or a best manager, so you want to become the best, okay, you want people to consider you as best. So for example, in normal social life, people at this level will try to do philanthropy. They will give money to others, they'll feed poor people, they'll help them in order to feel recognized, in order to feel respected in the society. So this is self-esteem needs. The next level is, the highest level is self-actualization need. Self-actualization is, you go to, in fact, Maslow also, you know, is not very clear about how to explain this level. But this is like, you go to a level where nothing drives you except the joy of doing that particular task. So this is like, in Eastern philosophy, we talk about karma yoga. You know, in Hindu philosophy, people talk about Bhagavad Gita, there is this thing about karma yoga. Karma yoga means you do certain thing just for the sake of doing it, not because you will get something in return, not even, you know, you will get recognition. Okay. So, but in other stages, people will do things because they'll get some money to satisfy their hunger, thirst. That is the first level. Second level people, they do certain things because they will feel secure, they will feel protected. That is second level. Third level is they are doing certain things because they are driven by, people will like them if they do it. Okay. Fourth level is they are doing certain things because they'll feel happy about themselves, because, you know, it gives a certain kind of respect in the society. But fourth level is you don't even expect respect from others, even for yourself. You're not like proud of yourself doing that. You're doing it for the sake of doing it. Okay, so that is what is self-actualization. And why it is a triangle, why not just, you know, a ladder? It is a triangle because very few people go to the top. If you see at the top, the area of the top level self-actualization need is smaller than other levels. Okay, so there are many people who stay at the bottom level, because for many people, even the basic needs, it's very difficult to get satisfied. Second level, there are even more fewer people than physiological needs. Third level, there are even more fewer needs. Fourth level, very few people reach there. Fifth level, self-actualization, very, very few people reach that level. Most of us in workplace, we are in either, let's say you have job security, we are either in social need or esteem need. Okay. So in esteem need, you don't need people to like you. You want people to respect you. This is like a strict teacher, okay, or a teacher who doesn't do things just to satisfy their students. He or she wants to teach so that he wants to be the best in that area. Okay, self-actualization is even not even that. You know, I don't want to be best in the area, but I enjoy teaching. You know, I really like what I am doing. Even if people don't praise me, I don't care. Even if nobody recognizes my effort, I don't care. That is the last level. Okay, very few people go to that level. So this is broadly Maslow's theory of need hierarchy. But there are also some criticisms about this theory. One important criticism about this theory is, according to Maslow, only a certain need is satisfied, you go to the next level. So if that need is satisfied, you won't go to the next level. So the criticism here is, poor people don't have the need for friendship. So you don't even have food. According to Maslow, it means you won't look for friendship, which is not true. In fact, there are situations where people forego their physiological needs to achieve something higher, isn't it? Like sports people and all, they diet, they try to put themselves to risk to achieve something very high. So it's not true that if one level of need is not satisfied, you will not go to the next level. People jump from one level to another level also. Okay, so even without satisfying or even without having been fulfilled at the basic level, people move to the higher levels. You know, in fact, self-respect. So if you take Maslow's theories literally, poor people doesn't expect respect. Not true, isn't it? Even everybody has self-respect. Even if you don't have food, people look for self-respect and recognition. So that is one criticism. Second criticism is, even at any given point, you can have multiple needs also. You might be looking for safety and security needs. At the same time, you can also have self-esteem needs. It may not be strictly a hierarchy. Okay. So these are some of the criticisms of Maslow, and also self-actualization. Maslow is not able to define what is self-actualization in a very clear-cut manner. So it is like very philosophical. So he is defining it in a very philosophical way. And also, scientifically testing this model is difficult. You know, there is no scientific evidence to say this model works or this model applies for human motivation. Okay. Anyway, there are limitations, but one important implication of this model is in workplace, especially in workplace, you can use this model to motivate people. Okay, you can understand, okay, which level this person is in. Accordingly, you can use a certain kind of a motivating factor. Okay, for example, if somebody is in esteem need, you cannot tell them I'll pay you more. You know, the argument we had about money as a motivating factor, you cannot use money as a motivating factor for someone who has reached a level where they don't care about money, they care about recognition. You know, it's not about how much you pay me, it's about how well you treat me in my workplace. Okay, so beyond a point, money doesn't really motivate people. It's all about how you treat them or how you make them feel about themselves in the organization. That is what works. You know, the recognition you show to people, the kind of status you give people, all those things matter. For example, you know, if you see very small things like having a exclusive parking space, so many of these big high level managers, they will get exclusive parking spaces, specifically allotted parking spaces. In terms of financially, it may not make a difference, but you feel proud that, you know, I have an exclusive place where I can keep my car. You know, this is my space. So that gives a sense of respect. Okay. Similarly, maybe if you are a fresher in a job, you cannot tell people that, you know, you will get a job where you will feel respected. You can, I mean, that will motivate people. But more than that, if you tell them, see, this is a job, secure job, you will be paid well, you know, it's a very conducive workplace, lot of opportunities to learn. So that will motivate people rather than saying this is a very valuable job. Okay. So to some extent, Maslow's theory is very true in organizational context. And many people use this theory to reward employees in workplace. For HR, this is a very useful theory. Okay. So we move on to the next theory. So before that, just look at this list. Okay, I've given a list of things which people encounter in workplace and in their job. Just look at it and see which one of them you consider to be important in your work. Okay, just have a quick look and see out of this, how many of them do you think are important? If possible, try to rank them, which is more important. Okay, so I'll stop here because with this list we are going to if you just think about this list, I will explain why I showed this list in the next class. So we are going to talk about a theory which is going to talk about some of these characteristics and how they motivate people in workplace. Okay, till then, take care. We'll meet in the next class.